RAID has long been an enterprise technology used in high-scale data centers. However, increased adoption in the home and small business market for NAS hardware used for media centers, photo processing, art and content creation is now firmly a consumer technology also. There are some RAID explainers available, but I wanted to focus more on the home and small business user and the enthusiast use cases and explain not just RAID options, performance and resilience, but also dive into how RAID parity works, as it helps you understand what to expect from your array. Solid-state storage capacity is advancing fast, but spinning disks in NAS units still offer superior scale and cost per terabyte, and RAID enables that to be done with data resilience. It is important to understand, however, that there are cases where RAID does not protect your data from loss. These include accidental deletional changes, ransomware, or physical loss from things like theft or fire, so backing up crucial data is still an important complement. If this content is interesting or useful, please do drop a like, which helps the channel grow. Also, if you would like to see more of this type of content, please also consider a subscribe. I had some really great feedback on the previous videos, and I'm working hard to make sure the content gets better. So with that done, let's dive in. Firstly, though not a form of RAID, it should be included for completeness, and this is JBOD, or just a bunch of disks. JBOD allows you to create a collection of independent disks, each storing data. This approach provides no fault tolerance, meaning disk failures would result in the loss of all data on that disk. It is cheap and simple to manage and allows you to collect different types and sizes of disks together, requiring no fault tolerance overhead, but it does rely on other methods such as backups to provide data protection. You can create your own fault tolerance by having data on a JBOD that's also stored elsewhere, but this is something that you have to manage externally to your JBOD configuration, either manually, with tooling, or with an application that uses redundant storage volumes. JBOD is most suitable where data is disposable, or duplication or replication of that data is managed externally by an application using the volume. Replacing disks in a JBOD volume is problematic and involves manual movement of data off the volume first. From a performance perspective, pulling data from different disks can be done in parallel, adding I/O capacity, but access to each single file is still constrained to the access speeds to the disk that hosts that file. Though files should be stored on individual disks, it may actually be difficult in practice to recover data from a JBOD if a single drive fails, and some implementations will implement the disks as a single volume, so the loss of a disk will cause the entire volume to crash. I would use JBOD with real caution. It may be possible to recover data from a JBOD volume that is on a non-crash disk, but I wouldn't take it for granted that it will be easy, and it may require effort, special tooling, and some technical know-how to achieve. Moving on from JBOD, we look at RAID 0. Despite being called RAID, it doesn't actually deliver the R for redundant, and this is why it's RAID 0. RAID 0 provides a very similar capability to JBOD. RAID 0 provides no fault tolerance, but it does provide scale and performance benefits. Now, all files are striped across all members of the array, so writing and reading files is performed across all these disks in parallel, and this provides some performance benefits for both reads and writes. I will take this moment, though, to note that I will talk about RAID performance for each of these options, but all the performance in the world from the RAID won't actually get you data faster if the network can't deliver it at that speed, and if the NAS hardware can't move it on and off the NAS quickly enough. So RAID performance itself is just part of the puzzle here. So RAID 0 comes with one considerable downside to know about, and that is that it actually provides worse fault tolerance than using single disks, similar to some of these JBOD implementations. This is because loss of any one drive in the array results in data loss for all data in the array. As each file is split across the array members, if you lose one of these, all files are missing some of their data. I would only recommend this approach if performance and cost per capacity is at an absolute premium, and that the data is entirely disposable, meaning that, for example, it's cached data that can be reconstructed, or the data is backed up, and you can afford to lose any changes since that last backup. RAID 0 can also be used in some hybrid RAID solutions, such as RAID 10, to provide the benefits of RAID 0 with RAID 1, which we're going to touch on later. Again, for almost all use cases, I would not consider RAID 0, at least for home or SMB purposes. And moving on to real RAID solutions, e.g. those that actually provide fault tolerance and disk redundancy, we're going to start with RAID 1. Now, RAID 1 is also known as disk mirroring, and it's a method where each disk has a second disk with an exact copy of its data. If the primary disk fails, the secondary disk takes over, allowing the failed disk to be removed and replaced without interruption to service. RAID 1 is most commonly deployed as 1 plus 1 redundancy, for example as an OS boot disk, but actually it does provide N plus N, where any number of disks can be mirrored by an equal number of redundant disks. So this is not typically used for large scale volumes, but it is possible if you're willing to pay the redundancy overhead cost. Write performance is broadly similar to a single disk, but implementation dependent, there could be some read performance advantages. It really depends if the implementation you're using is able to distribute read requests over the two disks or not. Now, not typically heard of, there's also RAID 2, 3 and 4, and I have never seen these implemented, and I think the reasons are clear. These RAID types actually perform similar functions as a common RAID 5, but the difference is how parity is handled in the data, and we're going to dive into how parity really works under the hood shortly. So RAID 2 is expensive, and it requires N plus N disks, it performs ECC error checking, which is largely redundant now as disks typically do this themselves in hardware, and it suffers from cost and performance issues. RAID 3 and 4 both implement a dedicated parity disk, with the first using byte-level striping and the latter using block-level striping. However, using a dedicated parity disk has some performance impact, as the parity disk is always going to be the busiest disk in the array and will become a bottleneck. And why this is, it'll become much clearer once we dig into how parity works. So this moves us on to RAID 5 and one of the most common RAID implementations. And this type requires a minimum of 3 disks, and again, once we dig into parity, you'll know why that is. RAID 5 uses striping with parity at a block level, and this means that each block of data is striped across all but one of the disks in the array, with the parity block written to the final disk. The parity drive is rotated for each block, and this is important as the parity disk will always be the most active, and this is because any change to data on any disk in the array requires parity information to be recalculated. So a change to data on any one disk always results in a recalculation of parity disk for that block. RAID 5 provides performance benefits for both reads and writes, although there is a slight penalty for writes compared to RAID 0 due to the parity calculation. This increased performance is due to each file being distributed across multiple disks, with more disks in the array increasing the potential read-write performance. RAID 5 provides N plus 1 fault tolerance, meaning that any one disk can fail without data loss. Though an array with a failed disk will be running in a degraded state and can have lower performance until the array is rebuilt or resilvered with a replacement disk. RAID 5 is usually very effective from a cost per capacity perspective, as you can grow the array and still only pay the tax of one disk for parity. But as your array grows, you should consider adding additional parity disks, as we're going to cover next with RAID 6. And this is because the more disks in your array, the greater the chance that you could lose more than one disk at a time during a failure event. We're going to talk shortly about the details of how parity works, but one consideration with RAID 5 is that the larger the array gets in terms of disk count and disk size, the longer the RAID rebuilds will take. As disks get increasingly large, without increasing the processing capacity in the NAS CPU, rebuild times can become very long and can put stress on the disks in the array. For enterprise NASes, this is usually less of an issue as hardware RAID cards are used and they're optimized for just this type of work. But it is worth considering that if during a resilver of the array, any of the other disks are questionable, the rebuild itself can put those disks under stress and it could trigger subsequent failures. If your RAID 5 array is degraded, I would validate that you have good backups of data prior to the rebuild, and really that's just out of an abundance of caution. Next we move on to RAID 6. This RAID type is similar in notion to RAID 5, but it offers 2 disks of parity, and it requires a 4 disk minimum. This allows for the concurrent failure of 2 disks in the array without data loss. So RAID 6 provides better fault tolerance and redundancy than a RAID 5 array, but the method used to generate the parity can be more CPU intensive, and this means there's typically a larger performance penalty for writes than when using RAID 5. We're going to dive into those working shortly, but RAID 6 also provides lower capacity to cost return than RAID 5, as now 2 disks in the array are effectively lost to parity, although again, the parity is not limited to those 2 physical disks and it is striped across all the disks in the array for the same performance reasons we mentioned with RAID 5. So just like RAID 5, the larger the array, the lower the parity tax, and this is because if you have 4 disks, or say 16, you still only need the capacity of 2 of these set aside to store parity. It's also worth noting that many NAS devices allow you to provision a hot spare disk. This disk is not included in the array and is just in hot standby, ready to be used to replace any failed disk that should arise. For larger arrays, this can be beneficial to return an array to good health as quickly as possible following a disk failure, but as I mentioned before, Personally, I prefer to evaluate the health of the disks and the backups before I initiate the RAID rebuild, at least for SMB and home NAS use cases. Now that we've covered the primary RAID types, I'm going to give a brief mention to some of the additional types that are known as hybrid RAID. These are usually tiered combinations of the RAID types we've already discussed, and they allow the benefits of different RAID types to be combined. For most home users, these are likely not relevant, so I'll keep it brief. First, there is RAID 10, and this is a RAID 0 array of RAID 1 mirrors. The RAID 0 provides the performance, with the RAID 1 mirror providing the fault tolerance. This will provide N plus N fault tolerance, meaning that for every disk you deploy, an equivalent disk has to be deployed for the mirror, so this is a relatively expensive implementation. There is RAID 50 and RAID 60, which are again a RAID 0 array of RAID 5 and RAID 6 arrays respectively. This allows for additional fault tolerance, but only if the failure in each RAID 5 or RAID 6 array doesn't exceed the one or two disks respectively. For example, losing two disks in one of the RAID 5 arrays would still result in lost data. Again, these implementations are not likely to be used outside the enterprise and only used in specific use cases there. So let's now dive into how parity works for RAID 5, because this helps you understand what the performance impact is and why RAID rebuild times can take as long as they do. In this visualization, we see that we have three disks in a RAID 5 array with data striped across the disks. If we focus on four specific bits here, we can see how these are represented in the magnetic medium of the disk in ones and zeros. So if we remove the parity disk for this block from the array, we can see the data left here that's stored on disk 1 and 2. Now, parity uses a bitwise operation called exclusive or XOR. Bitwise operations are simple and fast operations that can be performed using individual bits. Using XOR, you can evaluate two binary inputs and the result is 0 or false if the two inputs are the same, or 1 or true if they are different. XOR can be used to calculate the parity for the block, as you can see here. As we calculate the XOR value for each of our two data disks for this block, we produce the parity bits that we can store on disk 3. Now, if we experience a failure of disk 1, as we see here, we can use this calculated parity along with the data stored on the other disk to reconstruct the bit that was present on the failed disk, and this process will work for any of the failed disks. This process is also not limited to 3 disks, and if we expand the array here to 4 disks, we can see that the parity process remains the same. We XOR disk 1 with disk 2 and we take the result, and we XOR this with disk 3 and we produce the parity for disk 4. And again, a failure on disk 1 means the process can be reversed to recreate this data. This process is expansible to any number of disks. However, we can see that as the number of disks scales horizontally, more XOR operations are needed, and with 3 disks it's 1, with 5 disks it's 3, and if you get to 12 disks it's now 10. So for each bit of data or each block, it will take around 10 times as long to calculate parity on a 12 disk array than it would on a 3 disk array. And as this operation is done per bit, as the disks get larger, the calculation time also gets larger. And this can really only be mitigated by throwing more processing power at the problem with more powerful CPUs. And it's still ultimately limited by disk reader I/O, and this is why hardware RAID and SAS disks will be faster to build arrays than home NAS units, which almost always implement RAID on the CPU and use SATA disks. Now we have seen how RAID 5 parity is calculated, how is double parity in RAID 6 produced? This is where things are more complex, as using XOR will not work if two of the variables or two disks are lost. RAID 6 uses a more complex operation called Finite or Galois fields, named after the French mathematician Évariste Galois. The math is more complex, and I'm not going to try and go into the detail here, but the main takeaway is that it's a more complex operation and it takes longer. And this is why RAID 6 expansions and rebuilds can take a lot longer than RAID 5 operations. As well as providing better fault tolerance in the array, this parity process is, however, more robust and it's less prone to errors. So this is all I have today on RAID, but I'm working on a follow-up to compare these standard RAID offerings to that of Synology's hybrid RAID, SHR, and you can find that here on the left when it's complete. Please do leave me your comments if you enjoy this, or if you have feedback or believe I missed anything important. I do try and read and answer any comments that I can, and I do really appreciate hearing from you. But please also like the video if you liked it, and subscribe if you want more of this content, like the upcoming SHR video. And on that note, I will see you in the next.